Good morning and welcome to the 8th meeting of the Public Audit and Post-Legislative Scrutiny Committee in 2017. Can I ask everyone to switch off their electronic devices or switch them to silent mode so that they don't affect the committee's work this morning? Can I ask everyone, particularly this morning, to double check that they have done that? Before I begin today's meeting, I'm sure all members will wish to join with me in sending our condolences to the families and friends of those who lost their lives in London yesterday, and in paying our respect to all those who displayed outstanding bravery in trying to help others. There's going to be a 1 minute silence at 9:33 this morning across the Scottish Parliament, in solidarity with our colleagues at Westminster. And at 9:33, I will invite all witnesses, members of the public in the gallery, and staff to join committee members in observing the silence. We will then resume our business. I'd like to just tell everyone present that the cameras will be on us during this minute's silence, and to bear that in mind as you observe that. I'm just going to wait now until 9:33 and then I'll invite you to observe the minute silence with me. Can everyone please stand? Thank you. Item number one today. Our first item is to decide whether to take item three in private. Do members agree?
Yes.
Item number two. We will now take oral evidence on the Comptroller and Auditor General's report entitled The Administration of the Scottish Rate of Income Tax 2015-16. I welcome to the meeting Stephen Corbishley, Director at the National Audit Office, and Caroline Gardner, Auditor General for Scotland. Unfortunately, Sir Amyas Morse, the Comptroller and Auditor General, is not able to attend today's meeting. He was caught up in the lockdown at Westminster following yesterday's events and could not leave until very late in the evening. Stephen Corbishley will therefore provide an opening statement instead. Before I invite opening statements, I will briefly explain why we are taking evidence from both the National Audit Office and the Auditor General today. From April 2016, the Scottish Parliament has set a Scottish rate of income tax. The accounts of HMRC, who are responsible for collecting and administering this RIT, are audited by the National Audit Office on behalf of the Comptroller and Auditor General. To ensure that the HMRC's collection and administration of the Scottish rate of income tax is subject to scrutiny by the Scottish Parliament, the Comptroller and Auditor General is required to report to us. In turn, the Auditor General for Scotland provides additional assurance on this audit work by also submitting a report to the Scottish Parliament. I now invite an opening statement from Caroline Gardner to be followed by an opening statement from Stephen Corbishley.
Thank you, Convener. As you know, the Scottish Parliament's financial powers are changing substantially with new responsibilities for taxes, social security and borrowing through the 2012 and 2016 Scotland Acts. My latest report on progress across the new financial powers is published today, and I look forward to briefing the committee on that at a later date. The purpose of today's session is to look at the auditing of one element of the new powers, that is the Scottish rate of income tax. Specifically, the reports which the committee has before it relate to 2015-16, during which preparations for implementing the first tranche of devolved income tax powers continued prior to their introduction in April 2016. In considering these reports, it's important to bear in mind the respective responsibilities of those involved. Firstly, for income tax itself. HMRC collects and administers income tax and is responsible for the project to implement the Scottish rate. The Scottish Government is responsible for funding the project and for seeking assurances that the new system collects the correct amount of tax. And secondly, the respective responsibilities for auditing. As you said, Convener, the National Audit Office audits HMRC's accounts and the Comptroller and Auditor General is responsible for reporting to the Scottish Parliament on HMRC's administration of Scottish income tax. I report to the committee to provide it with additional assurance on the NAO's audit work, in line with a recommendation from the predecessor Public Audit Committee. This is the second year of this arrangement. In summary, my report says that I am satisfied that NAO's audit approach was sufficient and robust and covered the key audit risks. I'm also satisfied that the findings and conclusions in the Comptroller and Auditor General's report are reasonably based. I'll now pass on to Stephen Corbishley on behalf of the Comptroller and Auditor General to provide opening remarks on the outcome of the audit work at HMRC on the administration of the Scottish rate of income tax.
Convener, good morning, everyone. Can I just start by passing on Sir Amyas' apologies for not being with you today? He did want to be here, but obviously circumstances, which I'm sure you understand, meant that he was unable to make it today. I am here, I'm deputed to take our report forward with you today, so please bear with me as I take us through this. As you've already pointed to, the CNAG's role in respect of HMRC is to scrutinise both the accounts that are produced by HMRC and also our value for money programme within HMRC and report to Parliament, or the UK Parliament, on those activities. However, as already alluded to, because of the devolved nature of certain activities within HMRC, particularly in relation to the Scottish rate of income tax, under the amended Scotland Act 1998, the CNAG has powers to report to both Westminster and the Scottish Parliament in terms of HMRC's administration of the Scottish rate of income tax, and that's why we are here today. Now, this report is our second report where we're considering the implementation phases of HMRC's administration. So our first report was with your predecessor committee covering the 14-15 activity, and today's report looks largely at the 15-16 activity, which is the last formal year of the implementation process from HMRC's perspective of the implementation of the Scottish rate. Our key findings in the report, which we will talk you through, does look at the progress, in particular to some of the key risks that HMRC have faced in implementing this project. 16-17, which I realise is the year we're just about to complete, is obviously the first year where there are those devolved powers. We will look at the effectiveness of the controls and the implementation as we audit the 2016-17 accounts produced by HMRC in readiness for our next report later on. So some things I may be able to talk you through, but obviously some things are still to be resolved with HMRC. I'm happy to take any questions, of course, on our report and to put our report into context. Although, as you probably appreciate, some of the answers may be better directed to HMRC in due course. Finally, just to support the Auditor General, we have worked very closely with her and her colleagues under our Memorandum of Understanding in order to help the Auditor General gather and provide the assurances over the work we have done as well. I think it's safe to say it's a very good, challenging and productive working relationship, which we value greatly in terms of putting the report together. Convener, we're in your hands.
Thank you very much. I'm going to move to questioning now. Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Convener. I'm looking at page 11 of the report in connection with the error in the design of HMRC's taxpayer identification. HMRC doesn't have a great track record on IT. Can I ask, was there any cost to the Scottish Government of this error?
Yes, there was. HMRC tell me, though, they haven't passed that on to the Scottish Government, and the cost was around £150,000.
£150,000?
Yeah, in putting it right.
OK, so, but the Scottish Government didn't have to cough that up, so to speak.
HMRC tell me that is the case.
Good. Part of this seems to indicate that on page 16, 2.5, you're talking about approximately 850,000 records with a Scottish postcode were not flagged as Scottish. And then just below that it says an estimated 420,000 of that 850,000 were potential Scottish income taxpayers. Why is there that difference? You identify 850,000 who apparently could be Scottish taxpayers, and then suddenly that halves.
So HMRC hold records on... HMRC is, of course, a tax-gathering authority, but it was also a benefit, a payer of benefits for tax credits and child benefit as well. So it would have records across the whole suite of its activities on people who might be regarded as Scottish taxpayers. Then that distillation, that further data analysis would actually hone that down to the 400,000 figure we've talked about here, who are actually potentially Scottish taxpayers, as opposed to having a record in HMRC's database.
So are we saying that the balance there, the 430,000,
yeah,
are actually people who are on benefit, as opposed to being potential taxpayers?
Or they will have some other record, which doesn't necessarily mean that it doesn't lead them to being potentially Scottish taxpayers. Yes, in a nutshell.
So if they're on benefit and get a job, will HMRC pick that up automatically?
That is what this process was designed to look at. So when they do... When the database has been properly cleansed, HMRC would argue that actually that enables them to be able to say, right, to maintain that database, that would pick up their basis that they are a Scottish taxpayer. I think it's more of a question for HMRC in terms of actually that flow of when people move from benefit into being a taxpayer. And there's obviously not a linear process.
It all seems a wee bit hit and miss, as if everybody's feeling their way, because I'm looking again at page 18, 2.12. We seem to be very reliant on employers doing the right thing in order to maintain the list of taxpayers.
A lot of this does depend. Pay as you earn, of course, is managed by employers on behalf of HMRC through the real-time information system. So you do rely an awful lot. The tax system does rely for that particular tax stream on employers doing the right thing in terms of its flow of information to HMRC. HMRC clearly have a duty to ensure they're capturing the people in the right way to flag to flag the Scottish taxpayer. But it isn't all about HMRC. There is a lot of discussion with the employer community in terms of actually making sure their information is right. And when HMRC come to cleanse their information, they do rely a lot on employer information to help in that cleansing process.
And again, on page 24, 2.31, you're saying that 75% of large businesses have a workforce that is partially Scottish. Now, there was some debate originally at the very start of this, how big businesses that operate across the border would actually be able to identify and flag Scottish taxpayers. Has that been resolved?
I think we could say that's work in progress from HMRC's perspective. A lot of part of the reaction to the issue that on the taxpayer identification exercise tail end of last year was actually how can they use, for example, test their data. HMRC test its data alongside information from, for example, the larger employers such as the Scottish Government, for example. And actually, so again, it's using that data set and comparing that data set with information held on HMRC's own records as well. So they will continually refine the information that they would use to identify Scottish taxpayers. It isn't just a one-stop. It isn't just a big cliff. Clearly, that database does need to be maintained day on day, year after year. There's an ongoing maintenance of the database.
Given all these elements, how confident are we that we've actually captured a real number for the income tax that's being collected in Scotland? I think someplace in here there's something like a 4% error rate looked at, which is indicated. But again, in paragraph 2.31, you're saying 25% of employers there seems to be an issue with in terms of the responsibility to log workforce changes. How close are we to getting a real figure on this?
I think the easy answer for me is to say that is what we will look at during 16-17. HMRC, again, this is something to explore with HMRC. HMRC have told us that what they are continually refreshing, continually looking again at their database to ensure actually it achieves the clear objectives you rightly set out for this particular project. If you're asking me to give you assurances at this point in time, I'm going to defer that till we've done some hard audit on the figures as they start to come through based on the 16-17. They're moving in the right direction. That's probably as far as I would go at this point in time, but there is still some work they need to do for that ongoing maintenance of their database.
Is it, I mean, you're doing the audit of all this.
Yeah.
Do you have a feel as to what the possible real error rate is?
No, I we don't. I think what shook us all in all of this was that the 420,000 misidentification, if I can put it that way, out of the first scanning exercise that happened a year ago. That seemed to be just a procedural formulaic issue that led to a number of people being missed off the initial mailing list. So HMRC's action will be to bring that down to a reasonable figure. You will never get, I guess, 100% accuracy in this part of HMRC's activity. Just that's the nature of the flows of people moving in and out, moving house, moving in and out of Scotland or from Scotland into England or England to Scotland and vice versa. So you will never get 100% accuracy, but you want to get it to a point that it is materially correct. In the
scheme. So, as an auditor, what would you say a reasonable percentage accuracy would be?
Oh, I from that your testing. Me a little bit on that. I wouldn't like to be pressed on that at this point. I think it's. I'll say that I wouldn't like to be pressed on that at this point.
Okay. Ross Thompson.
Thank you very much, convener. I was wanting to pick up on one of the key findings round about the future divergence of tax rate and thresholds between Scotland and the rest of the UK, which is on pages 23-24. It states that. There could be a significant amount of tax at risk. Could you explain to me what you mean by a significant risk?
A significant amount of tax tax at risk. I think what we are saying here in the scope of the risk is as the rates and as the thresholds diverge, which inevitably, well, we're already seeing that for 17-18, it is absolutely essential that HMRC does maintain that database of its Scottish taxpayer records, or else actually down the line when it comes to the block grant calculations and so on, there will be a miscalculation, a lot to catch up on as HMRC regularises or reconciles the process down the line. It all depends on the records you've got and how those are then extracted to do those calculations for block grant purposes. Mm-hmm. That's the risk we're talking about. That's the risk HMRC understand. They know they've got to get down to a reasonable level. How reasonable, as we've just discussed, of course.
Sure. And you know, the report highlights that there is that significant amount of tax that could be at risk. And looking to the future, there are potentially two other risk if you look at either political decisions to increase the rate of income tax or if you look at the UK government who are saying that the UK threshold will rise in line with inflation, you could look at Scots potentially paying £1,000 more in tax over the next 5 years. So do you know what work HMRC are doing to mitigate against that risk? Specifically?
Well, these are political decisions to vary tax, and to particularly when you get a national divergent, there is a risk there. HMRC may argue, I don't want to sound as a mouthpiece for HMRC, but HMRC may argue that actually keeping track of your taxpayer records, keeping track of your of who is paying tax in the right way is fundamental to following through the financial consequences of those political decisions.
Yeah. How confident are you that they have the ability to do it?
I think we've seen quite a lot of work, as I've just mentioned, quite a lot of work that has been done since the original misidentification or the lack of identification a year or so ago, and continually refining, getting other data sources, checking those data sources against their own records. It's an ongoing maintenance issue for them, and it's not a static position by any means. Providing they've got that ongoing process in place and it works to maintain the accuracy of their database, that will address the issues you've talked about, because as rates do diverge, it becomes much more important to ensure they do that. This is, I think HMRC would argue, this is an ongoing discussion they're having with the Scottish Government in terms of actually how they carry on refining that within the cost envelope they've got.
And what work will you be doing to monitor how they sort of meet those challenges? Are you going to continue to?
Yes, we will. We've got an ongoing. Our statute requires us to report both to Westminster and to the Scottish Parliament in terms of that ongoing development, ongoing debate, which we'll do annually, of course.
And although it's slightly different, do you know if there's any work being done in relation to the wider economic impact of those risks? If there is a significant risk run about tax, do you know if there's any work being done to look at the wider economic impact of that?
I would probably pass on that myself. I think that would be a matter for you to take with forward with the Scottish Government. Yeah. I'm sure the answer is yes, but I wouldn't have the evidence to suggest.
Thank you, Convener.
Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Convener. Morning.
Good morning.
Just a very quick follow-up to Ross's question, just on to help me out. We have a slightly divergent tax system already. It is not inconceivable that will continue to diverge. Because what I'm reading is this is based on addresses. Where I live determines where I pay tax. Is it not open to me, if I live within commuting distance of the border, to relocate to a lower tax jurisdiction if I believe it financially beneficial to me?
I'm not here to act as your tax advisor. Yes, and that would be that. Could be a legitimate response if you felt that to be the case. If HMRC would argue, actually, that I think we've talked about this a little bit before, the residency test isn't just necessarily just about an address, it's actually where your home is. If your families are based in as you say, on the English part of that border, and you may work in Scotland, but therefore you don't necessarily live in Scotland, you would be classed as a rest of UK or an English taxpayer for the purposes of this exercise. Where HMRC can prove, or you are shown to be that resident test is you do live your home is in Scotland, that's where your children go to school, for example, that's where your family live, then you one of the tests that HMRC would apply in those cross-border issues would be a whole series of factors, such as where your family live. If, at the end of the day, if it comes down to actually numbers of days, they will exercise that formula as well. But it's not just a simple matter of just number of days. It's where you're deemed really to live.
I see.
But there's an issue there, of course, of actually whether it's avoidance or whether you're trying to do something which defrauds the tax system, of course.
Indeed. Thank you. So I'm actually interested in the... when this gets set up, there are a significant number of Scottish taxpayers who are missed, as Colin Beattie pointed out. That was then notified to HMRC by other stakeholders. I'm slightly troubled by that, because wouldn't you have expected that when such a system was designed, HMRC would have put in some kind of check?
Yep.
Some check and balance that said, it's now working.
Yes.
Now let's check it's working.
Yes.
Talk to me about that.
I agree. I couldn't really say any more than that. The cause of this was when they did their original interrogation of the systems. The parameters they originally used to go through their whole, is what we talked about earlier on, their whole record data set missed out an aspect of the information there. They assumed the postcode field was filled in, and therefore it would take the information based on that field. Not all information was input with a postcode involved, and that's why they missed. We've pointed to, and we've done a little diagram in Figure 4 in our report of actually just, dare I say, back of a envelope assessment that actually, if they'd taken these factors into account, they may have judged that actually, in reality, the actual number of taxpayers that they hit was far below their tolerance level, and therefore that should have raised alarm bells in their heads. They reacted, I have to say, they reacted pretty quickly following that stakeholder conversations over in December and January, and realised they have to fix this. I guess you, as well as other colleagues, did that straw poll in an office saying, "Have you had your letter yet?" And that was part of the debate they were a recipient of as well. And then they recast their formula to fix the problem.
But isn't that extremely concerning? That, because you used the word, they assumed.
Yeah.
They should have raised alarm bells.
Yes.
These are vast sums of money we're talking about. This is the revenue that the state has to spend.
Yeah.
And just moving on from that, when they found out they built an interim solution, why wasn't the interim solution already built, just in case, do you think?
Yeah, I think this is part of HMRC's IT systems are largely legacy-based systems. There's obviously HMRC spend an awful lot across the whole aspect of its tax base in refining and augmenting the systems that they have. And there is a schedule of developmental work that needs to be done, of which this will be part of. So there is it's not just a matter of pressing a few buttons and making it right. There is almost a profile of IT work that they need to have in place, of which this would be part to correct that. That is why they had to put an interim solution in place. Prior to the final solution here as well. So, and of course, we will look at that strategic solution which came into effect in October, just gone, to see how effective that is in due course. It's taken a long time to get to that point because of all the other work they would have to do in this space. Mm-hmm.
So finally, and I may seek to come back in later if you don't mind, convener, but given all that you've said, given the sums involved and the importance of what we're talking about, this is funding what we do all day.
Yeah.
Can HMRC guarantee that this is not going to happen again?
Well, my glib answer is, I think that's a matter for you to put to HMRC. HMRC have told us, though, and we will test this over the next few months, that they have put, I've talked about already, how they refine their database of information. So they've picked up on that missing 400,000 people they didn't identify initially, and are now continually revising that database of information, and almost getting to a funnel, funneling down in terms of when you've got if there is an acceptable number here of people you'll never really capture because of all sorts of other dynamics. But it's actually how successful they are in all those refinements and that ongoing maintenance of their database. HMRC have told us, well, we've done an awful lot of work since then and learning the lessons from all of that. Checking our database, our records with information held by the significant employers in Scotland. So we're continually checking that actually someone we know who's working in the Scottish government does have a Scottish flag on HMRC's database, for example, that will pick up the tax implications. And it's that continual data cleansing that will make this right, or that the success of this project will rest on, I should say. Mm-hmm.
Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Just to go back to the 420,000 taxpayers who didn't receive the initial letter in December 2015, that 2.45 million individuals did receive, that potentially creates a less informed group of taxpayers. So I just wonder if you're able to say what are the practical implications of that?
Forgive me, practical implications of?
For the 420,000 people who didn't receive the letter in December 2015, I appreciate they did receive a P2 coding notice at a later date, but what are the issues for people in that situation?
Yeah. So part of this fix is actually, as part of HMRC's, they have now been identified as a Scottish taxpayer, so the rates that they will be subject to will kick in automatically when it comes to tax calculations for those particular individuals. So now they've been captured, they fall into the normal tax assessment processes. What we've pointed to on page 19 of our report in figure 6 is actually what were the purposes of these letters in the first place. Now, it is clear that each individual taxpayer, as we all are, has a responsibility to keep our records with our respective tax authorities up to date. So that's the first thing. There is a duty on us all to make sure information is held. What we've pointed to here in this diagram is, you can see in the red bars when the letters were issued, But actually, if you look at the yellow chart afterwards, the spikes in number of hits, people updating on HMRC's database their records, didn't seem to necessarily follow when they got a letter informing them that they were a Scottish taxpayer. You can see in there that actually there are a number of hits following way after receiving letters. So there is an ongoing communication campaign that HMRC has and will have in place to through other sources, not just through issuing a letter. That's part of their campaign to actually make sure people are doing the right thing, and that's the same across the whole of the UK, of course, and making sure that information is kept up to date. So practically speaking, it is good that they've told people the consequences of what would happen and the importance that they attach to individuals keeping their records or making sure their records are up to date with the tax authority. But it isn't the only means by which HMRC have communicated the impact of this or will continue to communicate the impact of this.
So can we be quite confident as a committee that no one's been disadvantaged as a result of being less informed than other people?
We've pointed to the fact that a number of people these people didn't get the same information. The coding letters didn't get and the process from that interim solution didn't get the same information that the other 4 million did get. Might be at a disadvantage in not getting those letters.
Thank you.
Okay. Can I ask, Mr. Corbishley, on page 6 of the report, it's got key facts, and one of those is that 8.4 million is the amount reimbursed to HMRC by the Scottish Government for implementing the Scottish rate of income tax. Is that correct?
In the 15-16 financial year.
Okay. So the Scottish Government has paid 8.4 million for the implementation of SRIT. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay. I'm looking at the cost of that as compared to what we raise in tax, because the government here in Holyrood have set tax rates at the same as the British government, with the exception of the threshold on the 40 pence rate. Can either of the witnesses tell me how much is going to be raised in the next financial year by the Scottish government not raising that 40 pence rate threshold?
I can't.
We can tell you. I don't have the figure before me at this moment, convener, so I'll come back to you after the meeting.
Okay. I mean, I know you're not in the business, Auditor General, of giving rough estimates, but would it be more than 8.4 million, do you think?
Absolutely. The estimate for what the Scottish rate of income tax would raise in 2015-16, and we haven't, the reconciliation hasn't yet been done, the estimate was £4.9 billion. And it's important, I think, to note that the preparations put in place for the Scottish rate of income tax will be the same arrangements that will support the full devolution of non-savings, non-dividend income tax from this April, yeah. When the amount involved is forecast to rise very significantly to more than £10 billion.
Okay.
So you've got that sort of scale of comparison.
Correct me if I've not understood correctly, but that £10 billion is the whole of the Scottish rate of income tax. I was kind of looking for a rough estimate on the figure that will be raised by that, by not raising the threshold, because it seems to me that taxpayers in England will be paying the threshold at 45,000, yep. And we'll be paying it at 45,000 here in Scotland, and taxpayers in England will pay the 40 pence rate at 43,430. So that's quite a small, divergence. So how much would be raised from the failure? Not raising the threshold here in Scotland.
We do have a figure. I don't want to mislead the committee by taking a stab at it here. I'll come back to you very shortly after the meeting with what the estimate is.
Okay. Would it likely be more than 8.4 million?
My recollection is that it is larger than that, but seriously, convener, I think it would be more sensible to give you an accurate figure than to take a stab at it.
You can probably understand, Auditor General, the thing I'm getting at is actually, have the decisions that the Scottish Government have taken on tax this year, do they actually raise the budget in any way? I mean, I understand that the cost of implementing SRIT and tax income are probably in different budget lines, but actually, does the cost of implementing this, is it just offset by what the government has done on that threshold?
And that's the reason for the answer I gave you initially, that the arrangements that have been put in place will cover the collection of most income tax in Scotland from April this year. Mm-hmm. There will be decisions in future, I guess, about rates and bands up and down the scale, which will have an impact. But I'm not sure it's particularly relevant to pick out that one shift in the threshold for 17-18 in comparison to the 8.5 million. Mm-hmm. Again, Steve, I think, is looking to add to that.
Convener, I was just going to build on that. To be clear, the costs that we're talking about here, which over the period of not just 1 year, but over the period of time could be approximating around 30 million in implementing the Scottish rate of income, isn't just about the marginal changes in thresholds.
No, indeed.
For example, in figure one, we've pointed to actually it's that 10% mm-hmm. as well, that which is the bigger figure that HMRC are commissioned to the 4.9 billion that Caroline's already talked about is what would feed into that cost calculation.
Okay, thank you. Can I ask, maybe this is a question for Mr. Corbishley, do you know where most of this work is being done? I mean, HMRC has centres right round the UK and has several centres here in Scotland. Do you know where most of this work is being done?
A lot of this work, I might be corrected in a moment, but a lot of this work is largely done out of its Newcastle office, because that's where the payroll systems are and are monitored through. So it's in England, I guess, is the easy answer to the question.
Okay. You'll also be aware, Mr. Corbishley, that there has been a proposal by HMRC to close several of its centres across Scotland.
Yep.
And I suppose my question is, from your point of view, and I realise this is a question for HMRC as well, but from your point of view, are we losing essential skills here in Scotland by these closures that are actually going to be needed as these tax powers come in?
You're right. I think this is more of a question for HMRC. HMRC might argue that as they move to a more regional-based tax office structure, it's actually been able to actually maximise and improve on those skills that people have to deal with the taxpayer community. Of course, we will in due course assess how effective they are in that assertion. We've published a report in January 2017 where we looked at HMRC's plans for the regional office structure, not just clearly not with in which of course Scotland plays its part, but that was looking at the sort of high level costing analysis and the impact on that skill base you've just reported.
Can you give us the brief conclusions of that report? I mean, what was the National Audit Office take on HMRC's move to regionalisation and closures?
What we pointed to in particular is there are savings that can be realised, and it would be important for HMRC to ensure they secure those savings, but savings not at the cost of the effectiveness of the service that they provide to all taxpayers, whether they be individuals or indeed across the whole taxpayer base. We didn't focus particularly on any one nation or any particular group of regions. We look conceptually at the whole piece, and I think actually keeping a maintenance on that cost base, making sure that actually they can deliver the savings that are part of their business case, but also in ensuring actually that the service and the skills that people have to hand, that people are supported in ensuring they can deliver the services expected of them.
You say it's the balance between getting value for money and keeping the skills base. Is it the National Audit Office opinion that they've struck that balance?
I think that's yet to be. This is yet to be determined from our perspective, mm-hmm. as we see this strategy being developed.
Okay, thank you, Liam Kerr.
Thank you. Couple of quick things. By the error, you suggest in the report that HMRC may have created a less informed group of taxpayers. Can you just explain to me, what does that mean?
Okay, so if you write to 4 million taxpayers saying you are a Scottish taxpayer, what this means is you might be paying a different rate or a different threshold in due course. By a small population who don't have that same information, do they have the same information to hand in order to make their own personal decisions? As I've already mentioned, the impact of those letters may not yield that risk, but there is a particular risk there.
A risk of what? What are the practical implications of creating a less informed group of taxpayers?
The need to make sure I, as a taxpayer, am telling HMRC of my change in circumstances, telling them if I move addresses within Scotland, for example, that I've changed my address, and I do need to tell the tax authority that I have changed my address. I've just moved into Scotland, and now I need to tell them that I am now a Scottish taxpayer, or I live in Scotland against the definitions we've just talked about. That's the practical circumstances there. It's that ongoing helping HMRC keep that ongoing maintenance of its database.
I see. I'd like to move on to the fiscal framework. And you'll appreciate I'm no accountant, so this might take some time. From April 2017, the Scottish Fiscal Commission has responsibility to project ahead the income tax revenues for Scotland. So isn't there a risk that it will be unable, going back to our earlier conversation, isn't there a risk that they will say, we can't accurately predict our tax base and therefore our tax take, and thus it won't be able to do its job properly?
So the I will stumble through an answer on this one, and Caroline will help me here as well. Any fiscal projection, you do need a good basis of data in order to do that, which is your point. That's no different for the Scottish framework as it would be for any Treasury projections governed by the Office for Budget Responsibility. They would need the veracity of that data in order to project. So there is a bit of a risk in there, as you point, to ensuring that's the case. I would say in my answer, and then I will hand over to Karen, that as the block grant calculations, which is part of all of this, they will continue to be refined and adjusted over a two-year period, which is part of the settlement that you would have, as new information on the taxpayer database that I've just talked about becomes available. So it's not just a one-year estimate. It will then be refined for the following year, taking into account new information about how much taxpayers have paid in this regard to adjust the previous block grant adjustment. But I think I'll hand over to Caroline.
You're taking us quite understandably into the territory of the report I've published today on the next stage of implementing the new financial powers. I'll give you a brief answer, and if I may suggest we come back to the detail a bit later on. As you say, from April this year, the Scottish Government will have control of all non-savings, non-dividend income tax, and we've seen the prelude to that in the agreement of the 2017-18 budget in this place over the last few weeks and months. Roles and responsibilities are shifting as those new powers come into place. It's the case still that the Office for Budget Responsibility is making the forecasts of the likely proceeds from Scottish income tax at this stage. The Scottish Fiscal Commission is gearing up as it becomes a statutory body to take on responsibility for producing a wider range of forecasts, including Scottish GDP forecasts, and there will be an estimate of the proceeds for income tax in there as well. But under the fiscal framework, I think it's the OBR estimates that will be the basis for the block grant adjustment estimates that come through, and there will then be a reconciliation 18 months or so after the end of the financial year to look at the actual proceeds against the forecast and make the reconciliation to the block grant that's needed. So it's very complex, and relationships, the roles and responsibilities involve the OBR as well as the Scottish Government and the Fiscal Commission as this develops.
Yes, I was going to ask about the reconciliation. Forgive me, Caroline, if this is something we should do another time. But if the reconciliation of the projected receipts and the adjustment to the block grant happens 18 months hence, what if HMRC says there are X number of taxpayers in Scotland? The Scottish Government then presumably spends or budgets against a particular take, and the anticipated Barnett is set, or the block grant is set against that level. But presumably, if HMRC gets that wrong and says there are more taxpayers, there is more tax revenue coming in than actually happens, then over 18 months, the Scottish Government has less money from the block grant and less money from its tax base. And so it will be 18 months before there's some kind of reconciliation, at least, to make that right. Is that correct?
I think what I would say is that you are absolutely right that the identification of Scottish taxpayers is at the heart of all of this, not just the Scottish rate of income tax that we're reporting on today, but the devolution of income tax as it comes into full effect next month. It's why this report is so important to you. The piece of assurance I think that we all have is that 2015-16 was the year before the 10 pence Scottish rate of income tax came into effect and the problem was identified at that stage. I think that's been a useful wake-up call to HMRC and to the Scottish Government about the importance of getting this right. And you've heard from Steve Corbishley about the action they've taken to correct that. There is the continuing concern that all of us as taxpayers need to understand our responsibility to keep our tax records up to date, and that now matters much more for Scottish taxpayers than it does for taxpayers across the rest of the UK. And employers need to understand their responsibilities where they have Scottish employees as the whole or part of their workforce to keep their real-time information up to date. Now, all of that we're reporting on now is happening at least 12 months before full devolution of income tax and any divergence between the rates and bands that would have an impact on the amount collected for Scotland in that direct way. But it's been a very useful learning process, I think, for everybody to make sure that everything possible is being done to get the initial database right and to make sure that arrangements are in place for keeping it up to date thereafter. There's then a whole separate set of complications about the forecasts and the reconciliation of the block grant adjustments, which will come into play from the new financial year, the new tax year, and that we're reporting on today. And that's also a big part of the deliberations of the Budget Process Review Group that the Finance Committee particularly is interested in. But I think it's an indication of how complex this is and how important it is that the Scottish Government, the UK Government and HMRC get it right.
Thank you.
Alex Neil.
Thank you, convener. Can I ask a kind of broader question, which may be more appropriate for the HMRC, but I would have thought it impacts on the work of auditors. We're very often told, particularly for high-rate taxpayers, the more you increase the rate of taxation or the point at which higher rates are paid, then that leads to the loss of talent. These people moving abroad, or in this case, perhaps south of the border. And I'm told, for example, that if you look at the upper rate at the moment, 45% rate, which kicks in, I think, at £150,000, that 3 out of 7 of the taxpayers at that rate are actually working in the public sector in Scotland. That's about 43%. So my first question is, from an auditor point of view, is there evidence that the higher you charge, the higher you increase the levels of income tax, and I'm talking about effective levels, whether it's through freezing the allowances or increasing the rate, but is there any evidence that if you increase the effective rate of income tax, that that leads to people effectively leaving the country, either in the public sector, because a lot of the public sector will be doctors who could get good jobs elsewhere without any difficulty, either in the UK or abroad. So I'm not trying to argue that the alleged disincentive is only confined to the private sector. It could also operate in the public sector. But is there any evidence, number one, that higher rates of tax lead to exporting of talent, if I can put it that way? And secondly, if there is there any estimate of the elasticity? At what point do people actually decide, well, it's not worth the candle here? I mean, obviously, part of the debate in Scotland at the moment is, OK, you're paying a bit more tax than people south of the border, but then if your residence is south of the border, your children would need to pay the full tuition fee if they come to Scottish University. If you live south of the border, you wouldn't get free prescriptions in Scotland, etc., etc., etc. And the net impact is positive if you look at the pros and the cons, because obviously the higher revenue funds these services. But what I'm very specifically interested in is there evidence that effective higher rates impact on the export of talent abroad?
Please.
I'll have a first bash and then ask Steve to follow up. I think there's an awful lot in that question, as I know you know, starting with the famous Laffer curve and sort of economic theory, and that's contested. If we look down a level at what we know in more practical terms about Scotland as opposed to the macroeconomic debates about it, we know that the shape of the taxpayer population in Scotland is different from that of the UK as a whole, particularly because of the southeast of England and London. We have fewer higher rate and additional rate taxpayers in Scotland than we do in England. And I think it's fair to say that we don't know enough yet about the behaviour of those people, either in terms of people's ability to genuinely demonstrate that they are not Scottish taxpayers if they have a foot in both countries, as many higher rate taxpayers do, or their willingness and likelihood of genuinely making a move. As you say, doctors and other professionals often are very able to do that, given the demand for their skills elsewhere, and I'm guessing the pressures on public services if we do reduce EU migration with the result of the EU referendum. We don't know that. I know it's one of the things which both the OBR and particularly the Scottish Fiscal Commission are thinking about as they start to develop their ability to forecast and to refine their forecasts of the figures that come from Scottish income tax in future. None of this has mattered before. It's been a result of the block grant that it really hasn't mattered how much tax is raised in Scotland and what the behaviour of Scottish taxpayers looks like. It now becomes very important as part of the overall relative performance of the Scottish economy compared to the UK economy. And some of the data sources are available, some of them will not be. I think when the committee has taken evidence on my report on the next stage of income tax, you may want to consider taking evidence from the Fiscal Commission and the government and others potentially about what work they're doing to get a better understanding of those dynamics, which will be very important to making good and effective decisions about taxation in Scotland for the first time.
Because the reverse side of the coin is, of course, the assertion that if you reduce tax rates, laugh a curve, you increase the number of taxpayers and increase the revenue as well. And clearly, you know, if you are the Minister of Finance in Scotland, these would be some of the initial questions I would be asking, because it would inform very much what my strategy would be. I mean, if there is evidence that you lower the rates and you increase your revenue, as opposed to if you have higher rates and end up with fewer people, you know, paying tax because they've moved down south to avoid it, clearly that would inform your decision about what your strategy would be. I actually think, Convener, we should look at commissioning our own independent research on this, because this is a very, very important point about the future long-term security of tax income in Scotland. And we have powers as a committee to commission our own independent research. And I think we should ask the clerks to prepare a draft paper on that, which not to duplicate the work that's being done, but to build upon it, because I think it's fairly fundamental to our role in looking at the revenue side. You know, we tend to look more at the expenditure side, but in looking at the revenue side, answers to these questions are pretty fundamental to deciding what the right policy is.
Well, it's certainly an argument, Mr. Neil, that's been deployed by a couple of parties in Parliament recently, so it would be interesting to look at. Do the witnesses want to add anything to?
Only to say it absolutely is a central part of the powers which are currently being devolved to Scotland from April this year. I've published a report today which looks at the roles and responsibilities and preparations that are in place. It's clearly a matter of discussion in the Finance Committee and other places, and we'd be happy to help the committee with whatever work it decides to take forward in this area.
Thank you very much. We will consider that and take it forward. Do members have any further questions for the witnesses? Or Mr. Neil, did you have anything further?
I just want to guarantee that Liam won't be flitting south of the border to dodge the tax, you know?
I'll stay here.
Monica Lennon.
Yeah, just very briefly. It was just something that Caroline Gardner said in her remarks about the people who have a foot in both camps. I presume mean Scotland and other parts of the UK. To, you know, how much of a administrative challenge is that going to be, where people become more aware of the differences and some of the sort of loopholes, if you like? How much of an administrative issue will that be for HMRC, for example?
We've pointed to in our report from 2017 onwards about the compliance activity of course that HMRC will be developing further for in respect to that question you've just asked. It is that assessment I talked about in terms of actually how you define who is a Scottish resident for paying tax. This is an ongoing strategy that HMRC will be developing in earnest from now on, particularly as the threshold has advised. They're well aware that that's an issue that they do need to keep an ongoing keep on top of, because it does risk exactly the risk we've just been talking about earlier on.
Okay. This is something that's been touched on by a few members in the committee, but from your report, it is key that there's this issue about letters and communication and identifying potential taxpayers in Scotland. Has there been any projections on, is there going to be a loss to the public purse in terms of the communications perhaps not as good as we would like it to be?
It isn't just about the letters that have been issued. There will be there are already in place, and HMRC will certainly have other ways of actually telling or informing taxpayers as to what they need to do. So it isn't just about that letter. There will be other mechanisms there as well. That's the whole point. If that database isn't kept up to date, if that database if people aren't aware of their responsibilities for informing the tax authority, the consequences are that, as we've just talked about in terms of those block grant calculations, that they will be misaligned to the taxpayer community here as well. So that is the risk we've talked about. If you don't get your Scottish, if you don't have your database right, you will not have your Scottish rate of income tax calculations correct, and that does have how much and by what degree that will lead to that sort of national economic calculations being adrift. Exactly what we've talked about here today.
But as one of my colleagues said, I think a lot of that responsibility actually falls to the taxpayer themselves to keep their addresses up to date. I mean, is that the same as operates currently across the UK on income tax, or is that new?
It is the duty of all of us, whichever side of the border we're on, to inform the tax authority of our changing circumstances.
I mean, should we be... Sorry, Carolyn Gardner.
I was going to just add to what Steve Corbishley has said, that that's absolutely right. It's a duty on every UK taxpayer, and it hasn't really mattered in the same way until income tax powers were devolved to the Scottish Parliament, because we all paid the same amount of tax wherever in the UK we lived. That's now changing, and that's the reason why this identification and maintenance of the taxpayer base and then HMRC's compliance activity are central to making sure that people pay the right amount of tax and that the Scottish Government receives the right level of revenue.
Is it possible, I mean, I think a couple of my colleagues touched on this, that if somebody had a house in England and in Scotland, that they could register to be taxpayers in England? I understand that it's residency for most of the year, that was contained in your report, but how do you check that?
It goes back to some of the answer I gave earlier on. You test it by what the reasonableness of how you determine what your home is. So if your family is living in England and you work in Scotland, then you could prove to HMRC that actually you are an English resident and therefore an English taxpayer. If the reverse is the case, then clearly a taxpayer would be proved to be a Scottish resident. At the end of the day, if HMRC need further evidence, they will go on numbers of days that you physically live in one country or another will determine actually whether you're a Scottish taxpayer or a rest of the UK taxpayer.
Paragraph 229 of the CNAG's report talks about HMRC's compliance strategy for Scottish income tax, and I think that's a key part of this. Given current tax policy, with the higher rate threshold being frozen in Scotland while it rises in England, I suspect their compliance activity will be focusing on people who fall into that band, and particularly higher net worth individuals. Committee members may have heard of a group of people referred to as Willies, work in London, live in Edinburgh. Those are the people who've perhaps got the greatest opportunity for manipulating their tax status as tax policy diverges. And I think those are the sorts of groups of people who HMRC would be expected to be focusing on to make sure that the residency test is being applied rigorously and consistently.
Okay.
If I may just building on that,
yes.
As well, 230 we've pointed to them, and those category of people, the very high earners, regardless of where they live, they already have an allocated sort of relationship manager who deal with their personal tax affairs to make sure they're reporting the right tax in the first place. And of course, residency will be part of that assessment as well.
Are you both satisfied with the HMRC's communication policy that we're going to be able to properly identify taxpayers in Scotland?
We will test that, and we will see the outcome of all of that in the work we do in 16-17. We've seen the line of travel. We've reported on that line of travel. We can see how HMRC has continued to refine that database. I'm giving a cautious yes, but of course we've got to test that in terms of what we now see as the outcome of the first year covering 16-17.
A cautious yes. Okay. Caroline Gardner.
And I've already confirmed to the committee that I agree with, can provide assurance to the committee about the CNAG's findings. In my own report to this committee in paragraph 20, I make the point that the Scottish Government now needs assurance that HMRC's taxpayer identification strategy is fit for the future, having been through this initial phase, given its importance in making the overall devolution of income tax work for the longer term.
Indeed, that's the page I'm looking at. So I take from that answer, Auditor General, that you think they're going in the right direction, but it might need to be tightened up in the future to assure the Scottish Government.
Yes, I mean, you've heard from the CNAG's report about the difficulties that were encountered in 15-16. We're assured by HMRC that they've now been addressed. We'll be looking for that assurance, and I'll be looking to make sure that the Scottish Government has the controls in place to make sure that it knows that its taxpayers are identified and tax is being collected as planned.
Colin Beattie.
Just one question which came to mind, and I'm sure it came up in times past. People working in the oil industry, where are they deemed to be resident for tax purposes?
It depends where their home is. It's that's that residency test.
Okay.
Again, they will have a home, and that will be where they will be assessed as a resident. In making this assessment, we should say, and I think it is clear that people have got to pass the first hurdle of, are you a UK taxpayer? Before then, you start to think about whether they're an English taxpayer or a Scottish taxpayer. That might be relevant to that question as well.
Okay.
Any further questions from members? Can I thank you both very much indeed for your evidence this morning? I'm now going to move the committee into private session and suspend until 10:35.